afternoon, everyone. Hope you had a good break. Right now we have Deb Nicholson, who's Director of Community Outreach at the Open Invention Network. She's presentation is Handle Conflict Like a Boss.
Great, thanks so much for coming. Just to clarify, when I say like a boss, I mean with confidence and certainty and a certain willingness to get your hands dirty, so you don't actually have to be the boss. And in fact, when we get a little deeper, I'm going to recommend that not only the boss should be handling conflict. So I've been working with a lot of communities with different stakeholders, different values, different things. So I've seen a lot of different kinds of conflict, and this is trying to sort of codify that so that perhaps you can make new mistakes instead of ones that I've already made or seen. Hooray! In my experience, a lot of conflict comes from missing information. Oops, I guess we'll be doing that. So many years ago, and this is going to tell you how long ago it was, actually, I lived in an apartment with two roommates. We'll call them Alice and Bob. And we had a landline. Not only did we have a landline, we shared the bill for the landline. So one week, Alice had paid the phone bill, and she had left a message in Bob's voicemail inbox. We each had our own inbox, saying, "You owe me $22 for the phone bill. I'd like it if you paid me soon." Something along those lines. And Bob didn't get back to her or say anything, and they didn't run into each other in the house for another 2 or 3 days. So when I left for work on Friday morning, I noticed a sticky note next to the phone that said, "You owe me $22 for the phone bill. Please pay me." So I went to work. I came back on Friday evening, and, you know, it was like, yay, Friday. Except for Alice, who had written another 6 sticky notes about the phone bill, which had not yet been paid by Bob. I saw that, and she was in the, you know, she's in the kitchen, and she accosts me like, "Where's Bob? Why hasn't he gotten back to me about the phone bill?" And I had a piece of information that she didn't have. And I said, "Well, Bob is actually out of town at his grandmother's funeral." And she went, "Oh." So I left the kitchen. I come back a little later with my not work clothes on. All the sticky notes are gone. All of a sudden, one small piece of information, you know, Bob's gone from all the names that she called him when you got down to 5 and 6 sticky notes, to like, "Oh, that's so sad. I hope everything is okay and that, you know, it's a good visit with family." So when you see people having conflict, sometimes you're in a position to provide that piece of information that the two parties, that one party has and the other one does not. So what I'm going to cover today is why conflict happens and it needs to be handled. We're going to identify some of the obvious and less obvious causes. And then I'm going to go into some resolution strategies for individuals and groups. Now these are, you know, just like any kind of like, here's what you might want to do. Don't like quote me verbatim. You're going to have to do a little bit of localizing of these solutions for yourself. And first of all, conflict is natural. Sometimes people are like, "Oh, couldn't we just have no conflict at all?" Did anyone see the Firefly movie? Right? Where they drugged everybody, and because they couldn't, they had no outlet for their conflict, they turned into reavers and ate people and stuff. So conflict, if you don't allow it to happen, I'm not saying your project is going to turn into reavers, because as far as I know, no one's flying into space yet, but you know, it's natural, it's going to happen. People have different ideas, and those different ideas need to be handled. One of the common ways that people get kind of into conflict situations is when they have mismatched goals. So especially in a bigger project or a project that has a couple of different inroads, ways that people come into the project, or maybe has a couple of sub-projects, one person might be there thinking they're doing one thing, and another person might be there thinking they're doing something totally different. So the people who work at the boat and dog wash are going to have real different ideas, especially when you're like, I think we should use more toxic soap. It really does a great job on the boats. The dog people are going to be like, what is wrong with you, you monster? So you may be part of one overall umbrella organization, but you may have very different goals or very different ideas of what you should be optimizing for. So it may behoove you to give a little bit of context for where your suggestions are coming from. So for the boat and dog wash, you might say, just toxic soap for the boats, not for the dogs. And this is all part of like trying to understand the other person. So if you can see where they're coming from, maybe give them a little bit of context for where you're coming from, because, you know, this is not one of those things where we're magic and doing it right, and the other person is necessarily responsible for the conflict. But the more understanding you can engender, the better off. Another situation that happens is sometimes people are very passionate about one part of the project, and they lose track of the goal. So do people know what this is a picture of? A couple of, yeah. So this is, it's a Scottish festival, and they were attempting to break the Guinness Book of World Records for the largest number of Kate Bush impersonators in one place. They almost certainly won, because I don't think there was such a number in the Guinness Book of World Records previously, but they were having such a great time that nobody actually counted. So they kind of lost, I mean, it's like maybe for most of these people, the goal was not the number in the Guinness Book of World Records. They certainly seem to be having a good time. But you may have a situation where people get really wrapped up in the specific task and forget that it has to feed a larger goal. Another source of conflict that can be hard to dig out is when someone has a job or a role within your community that is really part of their identity. So like maybe you're running a nice project and you've given somebody a great name, like, oh, you're like the bug triage manager, or like you're the speaker coordinator or something like that. And they start to really highly associate, you know, like I'm the Hello Kitty ambassador or whatever it is. And then when you're like, oh, we don't actually need that anymore, like we automated it, which is what we do in the Yes all the time. But, you know, they're very associated with that particular role. So when you change it, they're worried there's not going to be a place. So when someone's role in your project is highly associated with their identity, you're going to get some static if you don't address that. You can't just kind of roll over that and assume they'll figure it out. And then also, you may have to go deep. Some people don't always tell you exactly, you know, what their issue is or what's bothering them. And so that means that you have to take time to do this. Sometimes I have a friend who really is conflict averse and like slept in this terrible bunk bed apartment in San Francisco for like a bunch of weeks with like a horrible roommate that wanted to sleep all day and would like yell at anyone who came in to get their stuff during the day. And I was like, tell that guy he's a jerk and that like he's still only paying for a sixth of the room, because that's how San Francisco works. And he was like, nah, it's cool. So, and that was a temporary situation, but if you don't do it, then you end up feeling kind of steamrolled and underappreciated and, you know, like you're constantly got the short end of the stick. Additionally, you end up with, in a larger context, like a project, you end up with a bunch of conflict lovers. If you let conflict flourish, it becomes this situation. And there's a lot of documentation on this. There's a book, there's a talk by Donnie Burkholz on, like, you know, how it's like if you've put a sign up, like, jerks are welcome here, like, they all will come. And then it will be you and jerks. So don't do that. Of course, you do need to weigh your investment. Like if you've been contributing on a project for like a week and it's really full of conflict and static, you could just leave. You don't have to stay. And sometimes even if you've been involved for a long time, this is from Sarah Sharp, and she said, there are a lot of FOSS projects, but there's only one me. And I've had that job, unfortunately as a paid job, like the one where you feel like, you know, the next call on the phone is going to be someone yelling. The next thing that happens, this is going to be terrible. Like, I was actually sitting, one of our board members came in, and I had my head down on the desk as if I was expecting projectiles. And she's like, how long's it been that way? And that was when I realized I needed to leave. And so sometimes you will get to that place and you should leave. Do not, there is no free or open source software project that is worth your mental health and well-being. So don't stay. So should you decide that the conflict and investment is actually worth it, and it is, you know, it is doable, and you have the spoons to handle it, that's what we're going to talk about next. So the first thing you're going to want to look at is trying to identify the obvious and less obvious causes. So sometimes it's obvious because people are shouting and you can tell what's going on, and sometimes you have to take someone aside or do a little bit of investigation. So I'm going to share with you, there are three different styles of handling conflict. And I recommend trying to understand first your own style of handling conflict and then the person that you're interacting with and what their strategy is for handling conflict. And people might be different. They might employ one strategy in their personal life and a totally different one at work. So it's, and or they may use a mixed kind of situation. So the first one is avoidance. This is when someone walks away and avoids the conflict, you know, or metaphorically walks away if it's a mailing list, right? And this can be a really great strategy. Like, has anyone ever lived with a couple? Like a couple that like to argue in the hallway about like stuff you really wish you didn't know about? Avoidance is a really great tactic for that kind of conflict. But it's not great for a lot of other things. When it can lead to like a festering, unresolved conflict situation, and the person who is using this style as a habit, like for all of the, you know, potential conflicts, may not even realize that they're doing it. And it makes them start to feel unconnected and invisible because no one talks to them because they seem to not be concerned about anything that's going on. And avoiding issues, you know, as a group, if your group is employing an avoidance strategy, it looks like support for the status quo. So if you have some bad stuff going on and everyone's pretending it's fine, then to onlookers, it looks like you're cool with bad stuff and then you're back at that situation with the pit of snakes. Accommodation, this is when someone would rather be liked than considered difficult, right? I love the internet, that's so great. It's like, like, you just are like, oh. Is what?
A dog rights violation.
Oh. Yeah, I feel like that dog should ask for a raise, is what I think. But people do this sort of thing when they compromise when they shouldn't, right? And you know, like it's maybe like they suggest a false middle. It's like, well, we're talking about the mailing list and, you know, everyone's kind of angry and shouty on the mailing list. And so the person who's like accommodation and wants everyone to be liked, the folks that are like, free speech means we can all be mean on the mailing list. And other people were like, it makes me sad. I don't like the mailing list anymore. And they're like, well, how about if we let people be really mean on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, and then on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays, we'll be really nice, and then no one posts on Sunday. Is that going to work? Probably not. This also ends up looking like a person who doesn't take the conflict situation seriously, and onlookers are like, you're kidding me. If I want to be treated nicely on the mailing list, I have to post on Tuesday, Thursday, or Saturday? No, that's not going to work. And then the final strategy, or category of strategies, is assertion. Some of the reading that I did for this calls this aggression, so it sort of depends on, I guess, what you... you know, what you think about assertion, aggression. This is a person who reasserts themselves and digs in when faced with conflict. My cat does this. Whenever, like, I don't like what's going on, I swat. Swat, 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 swat. So hopefully you're not actually getting swatted at by human beings in your project. But this can manifest as, like, competitive, ego-driven responses, like, you know, who do you think you are, or, like, I was here first, or, you know, that kind of thing, or, like, that's what I would expect from someone like you, or these kinds of, like, really, like, aggressive responses. And over time, this is going to wear down other contributors, surprise. If everyone else is on eggshells around this assertive, aggressive parrot person, then no one tells them when things are wrong. So especially if you're the leader of your project and your response to conflict is like, shut up. like, I'm the boss here. People are going to stop telling you when things aren't going well. And then you're not going to have any idea what's going on. So this is not a great strategy for your personal self to employ. And then to have it in your project, it makes your project look like, oh, that's the shouting project. Everyone goes there to get shouted at, like that old Monty Python sketch. So, and you know, if you want that, I'm not telling you how to live your life, but I'm guessing you don't because you came to this talk. So, you know, and it's, you want people to tell you when you're like, oh, that's not, you're doing it wrong. Like, you know, I imagine like Michael Jackson had this sort of situation with everyone in his life where it's like, okay, no one will tell him things anymore. And it's like, the plastic surgery you might be good. You know, that kind of thing. So, so in handling conflict, the more you know, the more you're going to be able to help resolve conflicts. Do you guys know what this plant is? Yes, it is. It's kudzu. It is a plant that is originally from Japan, and it was brought over to the U.S. in the 1930s. And then they thought it would help combat soil erosion. And in fact, it's the idea of kudzu as a invasive, pervasive plant is so big. It's people use it as a metaphor from everything from like hopelessness to racism to like, you know, like anything. It's very ubiquitous as an idea. Stephen King, the horror writer, actually wrote a story about evil kudzu that ate this like kindly old man that ran a junkyard. Like, so the idea of kudzu as this like invasive, terrible, like, oh, put that cup down and the kudzu will eat it like 5 minutes later. Like, that's a joke. That's an old dad joke that you would hear in the South where kudzu lives. Except that kudzu actually isn't invasive. The one place that it grows really, really well is when you've cleared some of the forest for a road. It grows up the side of the forest next to the road. And it actually goes in a couple, just a couple of feet. But it's right there on the place where people are the most likely to see it. So people drive by and they're like, oh yeah, kudzu for miles. That's only a couple feet. So if you're kind of just doing a drive-by and trying to assess conflict that way, there may be lots and lots you don't know is what I'm trying to say. So if kudzu helps you remember that, perhaps that would be like a great takeaway. But so let's talk about what some of the things you might discover if you decide to go a little deeper into the woods here. One of the sources of conflict is people not understanding history or not having the historical knowledge. So sometimes there's like historical precedent or like, oh, that person always used to do it. And so like weirdly, they're still on that mailing list even though they have a totally different job now. Like kind of strange stuff. I mean, you should fix those things, but it also is really confusing for newcomers, right? Sometimes you have to go back to, why did we do it this way? Like, that seems really weird. And it's like, oh, well, we used to have like a lot of different servers and then we bought one new one that, you know, got rid of all the rest. So, you know, that's why all of our software is like has 20 server names in it or whatever. So it can be very confusing, but sometimes you end up, I mean, those are like kind of more nuts and bolts, but sometimes it's a historical thing where someone has always been consulted on some particular type of decision making. If you're new to the project and you don't know that that's something that has always happened, it might feel personal. Like, huh, like, why did Kathy write to me after I said, like, you know, we're going to do the release notes on this new format? And it's like, oh, because she's always in charge of the release notes, like, even though, you know, it didn't make sense anymore. So a good strategy for dealing with things where the history is uneven or, you know, is to go back to what the historical motivations are and then reassess, like, what makes sense today. So you go back to the motivation part, not the actual, like, cruft of, like, we've always done it this way. And then work on getting buy-in for the new strategy that reflects the current reality. Another thing that can cause conflict is when you don't know what someone's motivation is, right? So they seem to be reacting like, you know, randomly to other stimulus that you can't see. And this, they may have, they may have information that you don't have. They might have some particular, like maybe their boss is very deadline oriented, and so they're always like, "Yeah, let's just stay real late and get it done today." But they don't mention that. So if you can find out what that is, I would say ask about the other person's motivations. Like, "You always seem really willing to stay super late. Like, did you promise we would have this done on Friday? Because otherwise, I'd rather we just go home and come back and work on it tomorrow." And that, when you have people that have different motivations working on the same task together, you can see different priorities. Me, I like to go home and not work until midnight. But if you've got someone who is being motivated in a different way, it's going to cause conflict. Like, "Oh, why are you going home so early?" Another thing that causes conflict is fear. And this one's harder to assess. So sometimes this comes from when we were talking about the identity, where someone feels like highly associated with a specific role in the project. Sometimes you feel like you're having a discussion like, "Oh, we're going to switch from using this language to this other language." And they're like, "I don't know that other language, but I don't want to say that. And so I'm afraid that I won't be relevant anymore. I won't look competent anymore if we switch to this new system or this new language or this new tool that I'm not familiar with." One way you can try to kind of ask about that is like, "You seem really resistant to us doing this installation in a different way. Like, I was wondering what you thought the worst thing that could happen is. It seemed like you seem so resistant." And you might get like, "Well, you know, I worry about who's going to actually do the maintenance on this because I'm not actually so great with Perl," or something like that. And then you can figure out, what do you need to do? Like, do we need to, like, let's send you to a Perl class or something else? So fear can be a tricky one. So I would say, if you think that's what you're dealing with, is to move slowly. And then finally, this is a little easy, but people overlook it all the time, is that sometimes concerns or problems or bugs are going to the wrong place or the wrong mailing list or to the wrong person, like someone who can't fix it or isn't supposed to be fixing it or isn't supposed to be getting that information, or that concern isn't being, you know, it's going to the wrong mailing list. And so if you see that, this is something anyone could do, is to say like, "Hey, I think you can back channel and say like, I think you want to put this on the other mailing list because you're going to get like a lot of like TLDR or I don't have time for this," which hopefully you don't have community members like that, but you're not going to get a good response if you keep asking for information in the wrong place. So, and then finally, you want to, if you can, try and help everyone get perspective. Sometimes if you have the same kind of meeting with the same people all sitting in the same places on the same medium, you will kind of start to reinforce patterns. And so if you've got like, "Oh, we always argue about this thing on our like weekly phone call," like try breaking it up. Like, "Hey, I'm gonna talk to you individually and figure out like why we have this super unproductive group phone call and we never resolve these issues that we seem to have." If you're in person, like, "Hey, let's leave the building for a little bit so we're not all in front of our laptop." Or maybe bring in a third person that could kind of give us some perspective. Like, you know, like, we seem to have really different ideas of what our manager wants for this project. Maybe let's go sit with that person and say, like, "Hey, we want to re-clarify what our goals are here because we both have real different ideas and it's causing us to not be as effective as we could." So what do you do with all this information? As much as possible, try and put yourself in the other person's shoes. Like, just because a fear that someone has sounds weird to you, it obviously doesn't to them, of course. I would also see if you can find alignment, and this is like going back up to like, "Hey, so we're employing these different specific individual tactics, but let's go back up to like our actual main goal and figure out what we're trying to get done and assess the specific tactics that we're employing and making sure that they're still meeting that specific goal that we share." Hopefully we share this goal at the top. If not, you know, maybe sometimes people are in the wrong place. But this can help a lot. Like once you're like, oh, I thought this was helping you do this, and you know, it gets people get drift once they get further away from the like high up lofty goal, and they get down in the trenches doing the work. Speaking of which, a word about who is doing this conflict resolution work. I am in no way, shape, or form advocating that primarily women do this, or that anyone do this when they're not being appreciated, or that having a referee or someone who is doing a lot of this work abdicates the rest of the team's responsibility for good behavior. I think, you know, like I said, if conflict is going to happen, it behooves us to all, when we see it, when we feel like we have that missing piece of information, to step in and do what we can to ameliorate those smaller conflicts so they don't snowball into larger conflicts. And then if you have a big multi-stakeholder, large organization where you're constantly trying to have these conversations, I would say hire someone to help you facilitate interdepartmental or interstakeholder conversations and pay them. So that's my soapbox there. But so planning for future conflicts, or planning for the amelioration of hopefully small conflicts that don't end up as large conflicts. So first off, assume the best. I know everyone has probably heard that, and it's worth reminding yourself when you're about to like, wait a second. Maybe I should walk outside for a minute and come back thinking that person is, you know, maybe has a rational outlook with, like, some information I don't have. Another thing that you can do is set expectations about what kind of behavior is acceptable. If you don't tell people what to do and what not to do, then, well, you know, it all goes to, I don't know if we're allowed to say the S word. Another thing that I feel strongly about is that no ad hominem. If you've got, say you're starting a new, you're opening up a new project, and you're having a discussion on whether it should be Ruby or Python, and it's all on the technical level, like, oh, well, I think the libraries on the Ruby side are going to be a little bit easier for us to use with this database, blah, 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 blah. That's fine. And then someone says, well, Python's for dum-dums. You're like, what? And all of a sudden, the level of conversation goes down. Like, and then and then they're going to come back with like, oh, well, Ruby's for hipsters or whatever it is. And then all of a sudden, you're not really weighing the technical merits of the two languages for this specific problem space. You're calling each other names. It's really hard to put that toothpaste back in the tube. Once you've like, oh, now I know that you secretly think I'm a hipster, and you know that I secretly think you're stupid. Like, you can't put that back in and be like, okay, well, let's just strike that from the record and go back to like, what was the library we needed again? Oh, yeah. So, as much as possible, no ad hominem, no name calling, no calling, telling people you think they're dumb or whatever, even if you do secretly think that. Try and keep it to yourself. And I know sometimes like people say things and you're like, what? But keep it like at the level of like not name calling. And this is especially important for project leaders. Like the groups take their cue from the top. So if you're a project leader and you engage in this behavior, you're gonna have a whole group of name calling, like playground style children on your mailing list, except they're adults that are supposed to be writing code. So, or the other things that you're doing. So don't, the ad hominem really has to be nipped in the bud. So, a little bit about scaling up this thing. So I think most of that is applicable for inside of a project. But we are doing this large thing where we're trying to get free software to win or at least get lots of people to use Linux or make sure the cloud is free so that we all have awesome OpenStack jobs forever or something. I don't know. So we have all of these sort of natural allies, group to group, but we don't always behave that way. I'm going to take an example. Many years ago, I was talking to a woman who, she worked in nonprofits, and she said, hey, I heard that there's like some free or software that I could maybe use for my office. And I was like, oh, yeah. And she's like, it's like open source? I'm like, yeah, sure. Like LibreOffice is really great. And then she's like, wait, am I supposed to say free software and not open source? That's a thing, right? And I'm like, some people argue about that, but, and I'm like, and she's trying to bring it back to LibreOffice, and she's like, but it's like a thing. And I'm like, so wait, you haven't heard of LibreOffice, but you know we argue about calling it free software or open source? This is not a good look for us. This is like, oh yeah, hey, do you want a disk? It's like installation, and it's like, what's going on with the fist fight and the antlers behind you? Like, pay no attention to the elves behind the curtain. And it's like, what? No. This is not a good look for us. So I wonder what we could accomplish if we work together. So we already code together. We build these platforms together. I work at the Open Invention Network. We share patents, which before we started doing that seemed impossible. And it was tough at first. But we could figure out how to get free or open source software into elementary schools. We could do a better job of getting it into municipalities for use in different places and not just in one individual place where your friend or your brother is the mayor or something. So like we could accomplish a lot more if we worked together and didn't bash each other's tools and languages and projects and things. And you know, I would like to see us win. I think it would be great. So one way that I would like to for us to think about doing that is having more face-to-face between projects when we do events like this. So we might say like, hey, does anyone want to talk about how we would get more free and open source software getting into elementary schools? Like, let's all sit around, like, not one project, not siloed individual projects. Like, how could we do it together? Maybe they want both Inkscape and LibreOffice. Like, who knows? So I would like to see us both at the micro and the macro level figure out how to get rid of the ad hominem and treat each other with respect and try and get the conflict to stay small and manageable. So to recap, conflict happens. If you have the energy and the spoons to figure out what is going on and try and provide that extra piece of information or try and provide that perspective or get those the two people who are having a problem into the room together and discuss it in a way that is a little bit outside of their pattern of discussing it and build a shared perspective on what the overall goal here is and then reassess goals, you know, the tactics that are being used from there, that would be great. And then once you've got that going, set great expectations, let people know, like, you can't empty your dog here, you can't be a jerk, we are not going to be nasty on the mailing list on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. None of those things are going to happen. And if you let everyone know when they arrive at your project that that is not okay, then you're a long way towards avoiding that situation where it's you and a bunch of jerks. So full steam ahead. I hope we can do that. I hope we can build a great, vibrant free software movement where we are able to work together and get lots and lots of things done. I, of course, have picture credits because legal stuff and you can't, it's important. And then that's a whole other talk. And then if you want, the kudzu, I didn't make that up, that's for real. And then Oren, who I don't know if she's here in the room, she wrote a great piece about why it is really detrimental to our communities to make fun of each other's languages or tool choices or distribution choices, etc. And then if you want to read more specifically about conflict at work, this is a Zen approach to conflict resolution. It had a little more Zen than I personally wanted, but there is still a lot of great information in there. So that's me. You can tweet at me, Bacon and Coconut, and I would be happy to take your questions. Thank you.
Do we have any questions?
title of the book on the last slide was Everything is Workable, but it sometimes feels like in projects you'll have people who are just conflict factories.
Yeah.
Do you believe that everything is workable, or is it time sometimes to put people aside?
I think sometimes it's time to pull people aside and say, so we're trying to build this big participatory operating system that people can use to empower themselves, and you're making it really unpleasant to be on the mailing list, and you're making it really unpleasant for us to bring new people in. So I don't think that you want the same thing that we want right now, and this may not be a good place for you. That's what I would say. I'm like a very low tolerance for jerks.
Hi.
Hi.
So what about instances where there has been conflict and like nasty words are said, and over time like that's walked back and everyone's happy, and let's say 6 months or a year later, the topic comes back up again and it's absolutely taboo. Are there any strategies, like nobody kind of really wants to go in on that, are there any strategies to kind of break that down and get back at the problem?
Right, so you're asking about when there's like a conflict, you thought you fixed it, and then it returns, like the boomerang conflict situation?
Never gets resolved.
Yeah, so there's two ways. You can go deep and take each of these people aside, or if you're moderating a meeting or an online communication, you can say, like, we discussed that already, and it used up a lot of time. It's not actually on the agenda today. If you want to put it on the agenda for next week, I'll consider that, but it's not on the agenda today. You know, if you have already resolved it, it can't be on the agenda every single week forever. Either way, yep.
What would be your advice for when conflict splits the community, let's say 50-50, you know, Debian, blockchain, or Bitcoin, or whatever, and do you have any ideas about how to handle non-individual cases?
So when the community is split, sometimes that's because the goals are no longer aligned, and it might make sense to have two places for people to go. I don't take forking lightly. It's definitely a lot of work, but sometimes, you know, like I don't know how that boat and dog wash stays in business. That's like ridiculous to me, actually. But which is why I shared it with you. But sometimes you just gotta be like, you know what? Maybe we need two separate things, and and that's gonna be tricky, especially if there's like money and trademarks and everything involved, right? At a certain point, if 100% of your conversations are like, you're doing it wrong, and you can suss out that there are two goals, it's better if you can sort of sort it a little earlier. Like, you know, if you have a situation where like one mailing list or one meeting is constantly like, half of this agenda is totally boring and I don't care. Like, oh, then we should have two lists or two places where we meet or two, you know, two working groups. And, you know, so that might enable those two parts of the project to, you know, get on with their stuff and get on with their own stuff and maybe maintain enough, cordialness to continue to work together but separate. I don't know if that answers your question. It was kind of a vague example, so, yeah, it's okay. We can talk more about it, too, if you want. Yeah.
One of the things that I've found is the nice thing about open source and being on the internet is that what you think are people might not be all one person, like one unique identity.
yeah.
I mean, we see this with like brigading that goes on in various forms and things like that. I think a lot of the conflict resolution you talked about works very well when you're talking to a person.
Mm-hmm.
But what I've seen in our community is there are people who will create multiple identities, and when one crosses a line, another starts to be more active. I'm curious if you've dealt with anonymous conflictees or conflictors.
Yeah, that's a slightly different problem and gets a little bit to the anonymity of the internet and kind of behavior there. Yeah, I don't have anything specific for that. I actually try to avoid parts of the internet where there's a lot of sock puppeting and things like that. Like, I don't read. There's a couple of things, like, professionally I ought to read, and I just don't, because I'm like, no, it's too much for me. So, yeah, so I don't have a whole lot to offer on that one, except, like, if you don't enjoy it, maybe find another place to get news. I don't know. Sorry if that's, maybe someone will give a talk on that next year, because it sounds like it could be a good one.
I was just in WA, and they had a car, boat, and dog wash. So
okay.
I feel your pain there. You mentioned in during the talk that sometimes you have a negative opinion of someone or something that they've done to kind of keep it to yourself. But as a boss, how would you, like, where do you sit on the sliding scale of being open and transparent with someone when you're maybe not approving of their behavior, or they've done something silly or something like that, and kind of holding it back and keeping it to yourself? Like, is there a...
Right. I think I know what you're getting at. And so what I'm saying is, like, if you see something on the mailing list and you're like, you know, someone says something and your immediate reaction is like, oh, God, you again. You know, hold on to that and then maybe kind of ask yourself, like, why is it? It's like, maybe you have to say, like, so we've already decided this. We're not really going to discuss it in this meeting or in this forum again. So, like, if you can do it in a way that's constructive as opposed to, like, I hate the sound of your voice. It's got to be something like, could you, every time you bring that up, like, it wastes everyone's time because it's already a decided issue. I'm sorry you disagree with the rest of the group, but you can't keep bringing it up. You know, so if you can try and figure out why you're having that, like, ugh, you're driving me nuts kind of reaction to someone and put it into something that's concrete, I think that is helpful. But not sometimes, you know, no one's immune from, like, being annoyed or like, you know, seeing, like, that particular mailing list, like, oh, man, what are they on about today? You know, but not putting that into writing, like, you know, if you don't have to. I think it's more constructive to say, like, I don't think it's really a good use of our time to continue debating this particular issue. Or this is out of scope and it really kind of makes the mailing list noisy in a way that's unhelpful. Does that help you? Okay. And I don't know what we've got. We have a few more minutes, yeah?
Yeah, we probably got time for one more, if any.
I suppose in the example you gave where, like, say someone has come on and said Python's childish or whatever, like, how would you, the two options I can think of are deleting the post and talking to the person, or verbally reacting to it there and saying this isn't going to continue. Is there one way you'd go, or?
Yeah, I think if you've already set expectations that we're not going to, like, call each other names or engage in that kind of behavior, then you can sort of remind the person, like, hey, so we don't engage in that kind of behavior. It's really not helpful. Do you want to try and rephrase that? Like, maybe you're saying, like, I don't think it's robust enough for this particular job. That would be a helpful thing versus what you said, which is not helpful. So I would give the person an opportunity to rephrase. I mean, you know, only so many times. Like, if you're, you know. Yeah. So, all right. Do we have time for one more? I don't know if there is one more. Okay.
What do you do if the problem person is the benevolent dictator, the life sort of guy?
I was wondering that one. Yeah, I guess it's... So I don't think a coup is going to be helpful, if that's what you're asking. Like we already sort of struggled to be like, what happens when the community splits into two? So I don't think that's going to be helpful. I think you can try and use this sort of, like, hey, I don't know if you're aware, like, nobody tells you when things are wrong because they're afraid you're going to bite their head off. Like, so if you think they're not aware of the impact of their behavior, you can try that. If you know they're aware and they actually just don't care, then I guess you have to weigh your personal involvement in that project and decide if that's something you want to put up with. I think that's hard. That's a really, really, really hard one, and we have several of those problems in the community. Really? You should give a talk next year. All right.
All right, then. I think we'll wrap it up. And that was a
really
great talk I did.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, thank you.